In this section, we want to study linear maps which are compatible with inner products on Euclidean or unitary vector spaces. The title is Orthogonal Maps and Matrices. After studying linear maps, we will then do the analogous constructions for matrices, and as we've seen above, they have basically everything alike. So we want to study this, and while the title only says orthogonal maps and matrices, which refers to Euclidean vector spaces, I will also include the unitary case anything. So a correct title, but it was too long from my point of view, was orthogonal and unitary maps and matrices. So how do maps behave with respect to the inner product? And first of all, I've got to make precise what I mean if I say a map which is compatible with inner products. So let me start with straight away with the definition. Definition 1030. So we have two Euclidean vector spaces or two unitary vector spaces. So with the one inner product gets an index v, the one gets index w, so we can distinguish if we're in v or w. These should be Euclidean or unitary vector spaces, and now I'm using a convention that I will use all the time throughout this section. What I will do in this section is to formulate everything for the Euclidean case and then put in the unitary case in parentheses. So this means basically if you read the theorem, you can either ignore the parentheses and read only the Euclidean case, or it also holds true if you replace the word before by the thing which comes in the parentheses, which contains the unitary case. So either everything Euclidean or everything unitary, both is correct, and this is kind of the most convenient notation for this point of view. So please don't be distracted by that. So we either have, they are either both Euclidean or both unitary, so both real or both complex. Now, a linear map F from V to W is called orthogonal in the Euclidean case, or in the unitary case, we also call the map unitary, if it is compatible with the inner product, and by this we mean the inner product of the image F of V and F of W for some vectors V and W in V. This is now F maps to W, so this is the inner product in W. This inner product is the same as the inner product of V and W in V before applying F for all the W in V. Okay, so very basic definition, it just respects this inner product, so to say. So applying F doesn't change any inner product. And as we shall see in a bit, I've described that inner products describe angles between vectors, so this actually means that F is angle preserving. So the angle between any two surface, between any two vectors before applying F and after applying F are the same. Okay, now, and just some notation, if V, distinguish the Euclidean and the unitary case, the set of all orthogonal or unitary maps, and now endomorphisms of V, or V with respect to the inner product, of course, is denoted by O of V, O for orthogonal, and in the unitary case, we denote it by U of V. Okay, this might be slightly confusing because U we use a lot of times as a linear subspace, but don't, I'll try to be consistent with the notation, but this is the set of all orthogonal maps and the set of all unitary maps from V to V, so the endomorphisms. Okay, see, if we have an isomorphism F from V to W, which is orthogonal in the Euclidean case or in the unitary case, unitary. So an isomorphism which respects inner products is called either an isometric isomorphism or for short, an isometry. Okay. And finally, V and W are called isometric. The same we used before, the two vector spaces are isomorphic if there exists an isomorphism between them. And guess what? We call them isometric if there exists an isometry between them. So if there exists an isometry from V to W. Okay, so much for that. So this is now what we want to study when we want maps which are compatible with the inner products. So some remarks and some direct consequences of this definition. Sorry for the cut, I accidentally skipped an item that I wanted to present here. Now, I'm keeping the notation here, so V and W are still these vector spaces. Then the first observation, which is very basic, any orthogonal or unitary map in the complex case map V from V to W is injective. Okay, why is that? Simple idea here. So assume we have V in the kernel of F, and we know to show that it's injective, since this is a linear map, it suffices to show that the kernel is trivial. Then we make the following observation. The inner product of V with itself is now the same, since F is orthogonal, as the inner product of F of V. So this is in V, the inner product in V. The inner product of F of V with F of V in W now. So this is just a special case of V equals W in this definition. But now, since this is in the kernel, this is the inner product of 0 with 0, which is 0. But then the inner product of V with itself is 0. So by positive definiteness of the inner product, V must be 0 itself. So the kernel of F is 0, and thus F is injective, as we've seen before. Also, there's another special case where this is interesting. If the dimension of V is finite, and then every orthogonal F from V to V, so an endomorphism, an orthogonal endomorphism, is an isometry. So it's also an isomorphism. And this is what we already know. If we have, we know that it's injective, that's what we've just seen. And if it's an injective linear map from a vector space to itself, it must be an isomorphism, as it holds for arbitrary two finite dimensional vector spaces of the same dimension. So this was corollary. Have I written this down somewhere? Yes, 723.C. Okay, so every orthogonal map is injective. Secondly, orthogonal maps are, and they have now geometric properties, length preserving. And this is what I mentioned in the beginning. This is kind of an idea to get there. I mentioned the previous video, I think. Length preserving and angle preserving. And this is what I mentioned before. And angle preserving. And what does this mean? So here I'm talking about the orthogonal case, because the angle was only defined for orthogonal, like so only in the real setting. So let F, V to W be orthogonal. Then the norms induced by the inner products, the norm of F of V, And now I'm writing this as norm index V, and by this I'm simply denoting the norm induced by the inner product, W, not V. This is the norm induced by the inner product on W, so this means this is the square root of the inner product of F of V, F of V. So, since F is orthogonal, this here is the same as the square root of the inner product of V with itself, but this by definition is the norm induced by the inner product on V. So, and this holds then for all V in V, we get this. So the analogous thing holds also in the complex case as well, but I'm just restating here the orthogonal statement. So we have interpreted norms as kind of lengths of vectors, as I've already told you before. So this means kind of the length of this vector F of V is the same as the length of V itself. So V really preserves length in this sense. And the same for angles. We have defined the angle between two vectors. If we study the angle between F of V and F of W, so between these two vectors here, then, like this, then by definition, we have seen that this is the arc cosine of the inner product of F of V, F of W, and divided by the product of the norms. So this is again W here, so here we have F of V times F of W, again index W. So we've just seen it's length preserving, so these norms here are the norms of V and of W, and here we know by orthogonality this is then the denominator, the numerator becomes the inner product of V, W in V. Oh, here's a V and here's a W missing, sorry about that, divided by the norm of V times the norm of W, so now we are in V, and this is by definition simply the angle between V and W. So the angle between, and this is what I mentioned before, so this is the geometric proof of this, so the angle between these two vectors is the same as before, so F is angle preserving. Now this is kind of the geometric interpretation. Okay, so much for that. So this is kind of the most elementary properties of orthogonal maps, and since you see that every orthogonal map is injective, this already indicates that being orthogonal is something special, so this is not non-trivial. And in the following theorem, I want to collect some further properties of orthogonal maps, and this is something I will not prove, because the proof is not very illuminating, it's just not very interesting, to be precise. It's just checking some properties. Again, I take two Euclidean or two unitary vector spaces, Euclidean or unitary vector spaces. It's just important that either both are Euclidean or both are unitary and not mixed or something. This makes no sense. Vector spaces. I need another one. I need a third one, sorry. The third one should be called X with the inner product X, so these should be Euclidean or unitary vector spaces, and now it's important either all three are Euclidean or all three are unitary and nothing mixed or something. So, A, if F from V to W is orthogonal or unitary, respectively, and G is a map from W to X, both orthogonal, unitary, and now you can guess what's coming. Then the composition, G composed with F, which now goes from V to X, is orthogonal or unitary in the complex case. So composition of orthogonal maps is orthogonal. This is kind of one of the standard properties we want and we would like to have. This follows basically straight from the definition, so I actually will not write down the proof. I mean, if you insert G in front of here, you can then use this relation to just show that G composed with F of the two vectors, the inner product of them is the inner product of the F of the vectors. Then apply it again and you get the original vectors back inside the inner product. Now, B, if F is an orthogonal endomorphism or a unitary endomorphism, then we've just seen in the previous remark that in this case F is invertible, and it turns out its inverse is again orthogonal. So this is now also from V to V is orthogonal or unitary in the complex case. So the fact that it is invertible, this is what we've just discussed in the previous remark. Now, and it's so in taking inverses preserves this property of being orthogonal, which is usual, which is really nice. And if F of from V to V is orthogonal or unitary, and lambda in K, and now K is R if we're in the, I don't write this down again, R if we're in the Euclidean case, and C if we're in the unitary case, if this is an eigenvalue of F, then we know that the absolute value of lambda must be 1. So all eigenvalues of orthogonal and unitary maps have absolute value 1, meaning if it's a Euclidean, if in a Euclidean case, so we have an orthogonal map, then this is a real number, so all eigenvalues are either 1 or minus 1. And in the unitary case, because this is a complex number of absolute value 1, and we know this is the unit circle in the complex plane, so lies, every eigenvalue lies on the unit circle. And this is already visible from the length-preserving property, because if V would be an eigenvector for the eigenvalue lambda, this would be the norm of lambda V, and this would be the, then you can pull out constants, so you get the absolute value of lambda times the norm of V. But since this is equals the norm of V and V is non-zero, this only can be the case if the absolute value is 1. So this kind of was the proof in given orally, and I will not explain the proof, so I've written the details down in the lecture notes. So proof. Lecture notes. Okay, so these are the kind of basic properties of orthogonal and unitary maps. And let me erase before we further study their behavior. We next want to study the behavior of orthogonal maps between vector spaces in the finite dimensional case. Namely, in the previous section we've introduced the notion of orthonormal bases. Now we have orthogonal maps. So the question is kind of what do orthogonal maps do to orthonormal bases and how do they behave with respect to them? And it turns out it has a nice consequence, or there's an interesting characterization here. Namely, if we assume that, so we have V and W as previously, so I just adapted the notation and the inner products are again indexed by V and W to distinguish them. I assume that V is finite dimensional. I pick an orthonormal basis of V, which I call B1 to Bn, these base vectors, an orthonormal basis of V, and I take a linear map, which I so far I do not assume it's orthogonal, just a linear map from V to W. Then the following holds. F is orthogonal or unitary in the complex case if and only if the family F of B1 to F of Bn, so the image of the basis under F, if this is an orthonormal family. Family in W. Okay, so far we don't know if it's an orthonormal basis, so we've seen that F must not be an isomorphism, an orthogonal or unitary map is only injective in general, and so this means that if we, then we have this behavior, but the other converse direction is really interesting. If something maps an orthonormal basis to an orthonormal family, which might not span everything, but it's still orthonormal, then F must already be orthogonal or unitary. Okay, how can we see this? One of the directions is easy, namely this one. So what we need to check is this is an orthonormal family. So if F is orthogonal, then the inner products of F of Bi with f of bj. This is simply by orthogonality, the same as the inner product of bi and bj. But as this is an orthonormal basis, we know that this is 1 if the two coincide and 0 if indices don't coincide, which we denoted as the Kronecker delta here. So this means this has this property as well. So this holds for all ij between 1 and n. And this, of course, means the inner product of f of bi with f of bi is 1. And f of bi with f of bj is 0. And this, by definition, is the same as demanding that this family is orthonormal. So here it already follows that f of b1 to f of bn is orthonormal. OK, this was the easy part. Now the converse direction, so getting from this property that's where we have orthogonality, there we need to work with vectors and coefficients in terms of this basis. Namely, so we assume that this is an orthonormal family here, so this f of b1 to f of bn. And so yes, I forgot one assumption here. Sorry, this as a set, of course, now if, if I've written it this way, some bi and bj might be mapped to the same point. So this might actually be a set with less than n elements. With here we further need to assume that f of bi is not equal to f of bj. F of bj for all I non equal to j. I could have written this in round brackets, then I would, actually that's a better solution. Sorry about that. I'm sorry, I just noticed I made a tiny mistake. I'm now writing this in round brackets, so I'm getting this in ordering, and I demand that this ordered family here is an orthonormal family, because just something that you probably didn't notice, if I would have written this in braces, so as a set, this could have less than n elements. So theoretically, this would mean that some elements could be mapped to the same point. But this is what I don't want. I want that they are all mapped to individual points and that the whole family then is orthogonal, that no vector appears twice. So this is what I get when I take this ordering in there. I'm sorry about that. But this is what we've shown here. So we already knew that f is injective if, since it's orthogonal, and so we get this for free. So we get that this, respecting the ordering, this is orthonormal. So I'm a bit sloppy here, but this I just want to express that no two maps are mapped onto the same point, which might be the case if I denote this as a set. Now, for the other direction. So assume we have that this is an orthonormal family. So we want to show that it's orthogonal. And so we have to apply f to arbitrary vectors. But since we only know about the bases, the idea is now that we really express these every vector in V in terms of coefficients with respect to this basis and then see what happens. Namely, so let V be a linear combination of the form I from 1 to n lambda I bi and W be as a linear combination the sum of j from 1 to n mu j bj. These should be some arbitrary vectors in V. Then we want to compute that the map is orthogonal by just inserting the, so we just want to show this equality of inner products, and we just want to insert these coordinate decompositions in there. Then we get the following. The inner product of f of v and f of w. So this is, in these coordinate descriptions, the same as f of the sum from 1 to n lambda I bi and f of the sum from j equals 1 to n mu j bj. And basically, we just have to write, just simplify until we have inner products related to these f of bi only. Namely, first of all, we know that f is linear, so we can just rewrite these sums here. So we can pull the sums and the coefficients out. This means this is the same as the inner product of the sum I from 1 to n lambda I f of bi. And here we have the sum over j mu j f of bj. And at this point, we can just apply the bilinearity properties of inner products. And here I'm just denoting the unitary case. The Euclidean case follows in the same way, just remove the conjugation bars that I'm adding now, because here we know just by linearity in the first component that this is the same as the sum from I to n, from 1 to n over I, lambda I times the inner product of f of bi with the second sum, mu j f of bj. And now I can use the linearity in the second component, and there, in the unitary case, I get the conjugations. And in the end, this will be the sum I from 1 to n of j from 1 to n lambda I mu j bar. And then I have f of bi f of bj. Now, I can use now the assumption, because now I know that the assumption was that these are an orthonormal family, meaning that this inner product of these two here is one if the index are the same, indices are the same, and zero if they're not. So this is actually the same as the sum I from 1 to n and the sum j from 1 to n, lambda I mu j bar, and the Kronecker delta, delta ij. But this is also the same as if there was just the inner product of the bi's. Namely, this is the sum I from 1 to n, sum from j equals 1 to n, lambda I mu j bar, and now the inner product bi bj. As this is an orthonormal basis, so we automatically get that this is also the Kronecker delta. And now we do the same steps as before, so we have now removed the f here, and we do the same steps as before, just in reverse. So first of all, we put the mu j back into the second argument here, then this becomes the sum I from 1 to n and lambda I, and now the summation in the second bracket, in the second component as well. So we would have bi comma the sum j from 1 to n mu j bj, so just by the bilinearity rules here. And now we can put these guys back in the first component. So this is the same as the inner product of sum from I equals 1 to n lambda I bi, and here we have the sum from j equals 1 to n mu j bj. And this is just v and w. These were just the coordinate descriptions we had for them. So this is the inner product of V and W. And we started with F of V, F of W. We have shown that this is equal to F of to the inner product of V and W, meaning V and W were arbitrary, so just some arbitrary vectors in V. So this shows that F is either orthogonal or unitary, depending on whether we are in the complex or in the real case. Okay, and this is what we wanted to show. So we can characterize orthogonal maps by their behavior on orthonormal bases, which is a really beautiful interaction between those two. Okay, this has an immediate nice consequence, namely, we give this as a corollary. So this is 1034. Now, assume we have, that V, and I don't need the inner product, so I don't use this in notation here, let V be a finite dimensional Euclidean or unitary vector space, and let n denote its dimension. N equals the dimension of V. So we've seen before that any finite dimensional vector space is isomorphic to K to the n. So as a vector space, we can kind of identify them. The question is now what happens with respect to the inner products. We have on Kn, we have the standard inner product, just this multiplication of the components and then summing n. So the standard one, the Killian inner product. But so on V, we have an arbitrary inner product. And it turns out that, so we know that they are isomorphic, but can we kind of just, do they respect the inner products? So can we identify the inner products? And in other words, from the definition before, are they isometric? And the answer is yes. Then V is isometric to Kn. OK, how can we see this? So here again, K is R if V is Euclidean, and C if V is unitary. So again, it works in both cases. So how can we see this? Basically, we have already shown this. Namely, let B be an ordered orthonormal basis, B1 to Bn, be an orthonormal basis of V. And we take the coordinate representation. This is the map we always called phi b. This was the isomorphism we constructed between those two, and this was just mapping the coefficients of this vector to the coordinate there. And we know that this coordinate representation, so let me just note this one, so the coordinate representation, this satisfies, and this was just by definition of these maps, phi b of bi, so the ith base vector, the basis vector is mapped to the ith vector of the canonical basis. This was how we constructed them for all I in 1 to n. So this means if I take the set phi, oh yeah, no, I have to keep the ordered set, phi b of b1 to phi b of bn, simply gives the canonical basis. And we know, of course, that this is an orthonormal basis. This is what we've seen, which is an orthonormal basis of k to the n. So an orthogonal basis is mapped to an orthogonal, an orthonormal basis is mapped to an orthonormal basis, which is in particular an orthonormal family. So using this direction here of that theorem, by theorem 10.33, phi b is orthogonal or unitary in the complex case. And so it's an orthogonal or unitary isomorphism, and this is what we define as an isometry. So the coordinate representation is indeed an isometry between V and K to the n, if I take an orthonormal basis. And so this is then needed to identify them. And we can now pull this even further. So we've seen before that any two vector spaces of the same dimension are isomorphic. Since we can just take both to be isomorphic to K to the n, and then take the inverse of the respective isomorphism. And this is what we can do now here as well. Let me do this just for completeness. So if V and W are Euclidean vector spaces or unitary vector spaces which have the same dimension and which are finite dimensional, so dim V is the same as dim W, which is smaller than infinity, then V and W are isometric. OK, now I don't have space for the proof here, but I think I can put it in here. Maybe let me give it a try, because this is really simple. So proof. So let F an isometry be an isometry from V to Kn, and G be an isometry from W to Kn, be isometries. So they exist by the previous corollary. Then by the theorem which had properties of orthogonal maps, we know that first of all, composition of isomorphisms is an isomorphism, and we've seen the composition of unitary and orthogonal maps are orthogonal and unitary, and this was 1032. We can namely now do the following. We just take first F, by which we go from V to Kn, but then we go from Kn to V by composing this with G inverse. So this is an isometry. This is for this from the theorem. So V and W are isometric. Okay, next up we shall study, so this is kind of the basic properties of orthogonal and unitary maps. The next thing is now to study matrices and to see when to define orthogonality and unitarity, is this a word? I don't know, being unitary for matrices, and discuss their properties, and then we kind of can discuss how we can recognize from a matrix if it's orthogonal or unitary or not. Okay, let me erase. Let's take a look at matrices. We have so far seen orthogonality and unitarity of linear maps, in particular of endomorphisms. And for matrices, we want to restrict to the realm of quadratic matrices. So matrices which induce an endomorphism from Rn to Rn, so an endomorphism of Rn or of Cn in the complex case. So let's take a look at this. And actually, we have already included some notion of orthogonality, namely simply by the induced by the maps induced by matrices. They are special cases of linear maps, which you of course can use then the previous notion of orthogonality and unitarity. And this is precisely the way we will now define this for matrices. Just to be precise, I will once formulate this for matrices, but it will turn out it's nothing new. So definition 1036: let n and n. And consider in part A R to the n with the standard inner product as a Euclidean vector space. Then a matrix A in an n by n matrix with entries in R is called orthogonal. If matrix multiplication has this orthogonality property, and this means explicitly that AV, AW as the inner product is the same as the inner product of V and W, and that this holds for all V and W in Rn. Okay, so far so good. So this is just multiplication with matrices, or just technically this is the, we apply the induced map on Rn to the vectors, but anyway, so this is orthogonal. Now, the set of all, maybe put this more in short term. So the set of all orthogonal matrices will be denoted ON. So ON is defined to be the set of all real n by n matrices which are orthogonal. And this is called the orthogonal group in dimension n. In dimension n. So this name already gives something away, namely that it's a group and a group with respect to the matrix product. Same as we had the general linear group and the special linear group already. But the orthogonal group is also a group, which we'll discuss in a bit, but the name is already given this away. Okay, this is the orthogonal group in dimension n, and these are orthogonal matrices. Now let's do the complex situation. Here we, of course, have Rn replaced by Cn with the standard inner product. So we component-wise multiply the one component and the conjugate of the same component in the other vector, and then take the sum afterwards. Now a matrix A, a complex C by C matrix, is unitary in the same way if AV, AW, to the inner product is the inner product VW, only this time this is the complex standard inner product for all VW in CN. Now, in the same way as we defined the orthogonal matrices, we let UN denote the set of all unitary n by n matrices and this is called the unitary group in dimension n. Unitary group in dimension n. And in the same way as for the orthogonal group, this is again group with respect to the matrix product, which is given away by the name as well. Now, okay, so far so good. This is kind of the straightforward generalization, and that's, collect some observations here in a remark. So first of all, one checks easily that this notion of this definition of orthogonality and unitarity coincides with Lorentz endomorphisms in the following sense that A is orthogonal, so a real n by n matrix. I'm writing this down again. If and only if the induced map FA from Rn to Rn, which is now a linear map, is orthogonal in the sense of the previous definition. And in the same way for the unitary setting, so if we have a complex n by n matrix, this is unitary if and only if FA, which is now a map from CN to CN, is unitary. So these two definitions make sense, so somehow they fit well within each other. Now, we've seen before that, so this was in remark 1031. There we've seen that, no, this was not, sorry, not remark 1031, it was, sorry, theorem 1032. So there we've seen that the inverse of, first of all, we've seen, since they have the same vector space, every orthogonal map from Rn to Rn is an isometry. This is what we've seen. And same for the complex Cn to Cn, every unitary map there is an isometry. Now they are isomorphisms. And in this theorem, we have seen that the inverse maps are again orthogonal or unitary in the complex setting. So by this theorem, it follows if we study the inverse maps and kind of look at the way how inverse matrices are defined, it follows that the inverse, every A in On, first of all, is invertible. With inverse again in On, and same in the unitary setting, so every unitary n by n matrix is invertible and its inverse is again unitary, and it follows, so we've seen the composition of orthogonal maps is orthogonal, and we know that composition corresponds to matrix product, so it also follows that products of orthogonal matrices are orthogonal matrices, and products of unitary matrices are unitary matrices. First of all, this here shows that On is contained in GLNR and UN is in GLNC. Moreover, one shows that On and UN are groups with respect to the matrix product. So they are groups, which means they are also really interesting from an algebraic perspective, and there's indeed a lot of algebra representation theory and so on, and there's a lot of things you can do with these groups, and depending on which field of physics you could specialize on, I think you will also need some of this algebra and some of these really interesting and intricate connections, but they are kind of well beyond what I can do in this course. But I can, if you're So just so you know, there is kind of there's a lot more to do. So there are mountains behind what you can see, and behind the horizon. So far, so let me just keep it at that. Now, first of all, we have now orthogonal matrices and orthogonal endomorphisms. And of course, you might guess what I want to do next, namely, is this compatible with respect to matrix representations of endomorphisms? And if I'm asking in this suggestive way, the answer is yes. Namely, in the following way, theorem 1038. So that, again, V with an inner product, be a Euclidean or a unitary vector space. That B, and this is now the point, so we cannot take an arbitrary basis to get an orthogonal matrix, but an orthonormal basis. Because an arbitrary basis, of course, could do strange things, so we might have really wildly different vectors or whatever, so you need to kind of take a measure, and this is taken by taking the orthonormal basis. So B, an orthonormal basis of V, and F, be an endomorphism. So linear map from V to V. Then F is orthogonal or unitary in the unitary setting, orthogonal or unitary in the sense from before, if and only if the representation, the matrix representation of F with respect to this orthonormal basis, this is now a matrix, if this is orthogonal or unitary in the complex setting. So here, this is now endomorphism matrix, and so this shows that these two definitions really are beautifully coincide as soon as we restrict to orthonormal basis, which we should always do if we are kind of working in inner product spaces. Okay, now, how to see this? This is actually not very hard, because we've basically already done all the work. So, let's first do this direction. So we want to show that the matrix representation is orthogonal. And it turns out, so first of all, that, I forgot something. This is finite dimensional. Otherwise, I cannot talk about matrix representations. Sorry. There are also generalizations of this in infinite dimensions, but this I want to keep away from this course. A finite dimensional inner product space with a Euclidean or unitary vector space. And now we assume that F is orthogonal. So let N be the dimension of the vector space. And just for abbreviation, we just denote the matrix representation with respect to B by A. So we have seen in the proof of corollary 1034, was it? Yes. Of corollary. This was the corollary that stated that every finite dimensional Euclidean or unitary vector space is isometric to k to the n. So there we've seen that the coordinate representations with respect to an orthonormal basis are isometries. This is what we've seen. So by the proof of the coordinate representation with respect to this orthonormal basis here, which is now going from V to Kn, and now again, K is the real numbers if V is Euclidean, and K is the complex numbers if V is unitary. So the coordinate representation is an isometry. But then, you just have to think about the following. If we take a look at the map induced by this matrix representation. So, this is now a bit, the notation is not good because this is again an F, sorry about that. This is the induced map by this. So this is then explicitly, and this is the way the matrix representation is defined. So we take F and then precompose it with phi b to the minus one and put in phi b in the end there. So this was the definition of the matrix representation, that the map which it induces has this form. So this is a composition of orthogonal maps. F is orthogonal by assumption. These are orthogonal by this what we've already seen. or unitary. So this means as a composition of this is again orthogonal or unitary in the complex case. And this was by theorem 1032, which showed that compositions of orthogonal or unitary maps are again orthogonal or unitary. Okay, for the other direction, we assume that the matrix is the matrix A, so I keep this notation, this matrix representation is orthogonal. This means, as we've seen in the previous remark, so this was remark 1037.1. FA is orthogonal, so FA is going from KN to KN is orthogonal or unitary in the complex case. But given this form, we can just write F as F is now the same as phi b to the minus 1, if we just apply phi b minus 1 to the, both sides of here, and then apply phi b from the right, which means this is the same as this composition here. And now this is still orthogonal or unitary, nothing changed about that. This is now orthogonal, so this is again orthogonal or unitary given if we're in the real or the complex case. So this already shows the claim. So the only key thing is here that the coordinate representations with respect to an orthonormal basis, that's important here, they are orthogonal or unitary, and so these terms here coincide. Okay, this is now a beautiful connection. Now, the next idea is now that we kind of want to study orthogonal and unitary matrices and go on with that, but this time go away from this endomorphism viewpoint, but just take some algebraic properties. So kind of if we compute with matrices, matrices as kind of rectangles of numbers, can we characterize orthogonality differently without referring to endomorphisms and without this inner product? So what properties do the matrix entries need to have so in order for a matrix to be orthogonal? And it turns out that in the orthogonal, in the unitary setting, there are really beautiful descriptions and really purely simple formula where you can determine if a matrix is orthogonal or not. Yes, for the next thing I need to draw a matrix, which is not enough space here, so let me erase and then continue with the next descriptions.